beautiful data because we use labeling techniques like deuterium labeling and CFSE labeling, BRDU labeling. There's several groups of modelers involved, and we compete a little bit with each other on what is the best model to interpret this data. And the end of the story is that there is no consensus. Estimates for memory lifespans vary from a few weeks to years, and estimates for naive lifespans also vary from months to a decade. So the take-home message of this slide is parameter estimation in the immune system is a nightmare. And this is something that we have to do very, very carefully. And that sometimes makes me ask questions if I see models with very many parameters in it, because I know it's very difficult to estimate all the parameters. Okay, but this is just my second life. And we now go to lymphocyte migration. This is an introduction slide just to get us all on the same level. I think everybody knows that immune responses develop in draining lymph nodes. So this is a beautiful slide. So suppose there is some infection going on in a peripheral tissue. Then the first thing that happens is that dendritic cells pick up antigen, go to the draining lymph node. They then present this antigen there. And then basically they cause an inflammation reaction. And basically 50% of all your lymphocytes of the body go to this one draining lymph node. And they scan the T-cell area there to see if there's if they have the right, dendritic cells are presenting the right antigen. And those cells that recognize the right antigen on a dendritic cell, they will clonally expand, they go into circulation, and then they will egress and go into the inflamed tissue to clear the antigen. And I'm putting up this slide because this story immediately involves a problem, because we know that a very small fraction of all the T-cells in the body is specific for any particular antigen. 1 in 100,000, 1 in 1,000,000 is the ballpark estimate. So you can ask the question, how long would it take if I have a small population of dendritic cells in one lymph node presenting one particular antigen, and then I have these billions of lymphocytes that have to travel through this lymph node and contact these very few dendritic cells, how long would that take? Would that take a day, 2 weeks, 2 years, or 20 years? It's very difficult to have a good intuition on it, and this seems like a very hard problem. And some people have referred to this as a needle in a haystack problem. How do we find, how do the T cells find this, these very few presenting dendritic cells? And then somewhere in the middle of the talk, I will show you that based upon the sort of modeling that we do, I think this needle of a haystack problem is not much of a problem at all, and the time scale of finding this is just a few hours. Okay, then I have a few introductory slides on the techniques. So I will show you movies indeed, without popcorn. The first movies are done with this new, relatively new technique called two-photon microscopy. And the last movies that I will show are done with confocal microscopy. And two-photon microscopy is really a very beautiful technique because people use a laser with a longer wavelength such that you can penetrate deeper into the tissue. And to get excitation, the fluorophore has to accept two photons, which means that you can get very focused images in the focal plane of your analysis, very little phototoxicity, and deep penetration into the tissue. So just with a microscope and a laser, you can go into the tissue and see cells that are moving there. Here is an example. Here is a mouse. One of its lymph nodes has been exposed and then put under this microscope. This mouse is anesthetized and still alive. And we can monitor within that lymph node of the mouse the movement of the cells. So what you basically have to do in this mouse is beforehand you inject fluorophore labeled cells, like the T cells that you're interested in and the dendritic cells that you're interested in. And then on real time you can make movies of these cells traveling through the lymph node of this mouse. And people have now done this with very many different tissues. You can open up a mouse, study the spleen, you can study the gut, the lungs, of many of these tissues. We now have really beautiful movies. I love this approach because we can really now see what is going on. Until now, we had to measure, for instance, how a cytotoxic T cell would kill a target cell. With this sort of technique, you can really see it, visualize it, how a CTL finds a target, latches onto it, and then take how long it takes to kill that target. Okay, so what the technique basically does, you have this laser beam scanning the tissue, so in X, Y coordinate it scans a field, and then it goes to a deeper layer. You build up these stacks, and then with software you render this into three-dimensional movies. And what people often do is they do this maximum intensity plot. So they scan in the Z direction, they get the maximum fluorescent intensity of the field. And basically why I think this is appropriate for this symposium, this technique delivers very rich and complex data sets, and I will show you that they are not so easy to quantify. It's really tricky. So here is an example from Sarah Hendrickson in the lab of Uli van Andrian. This is a lymph node. In this lymph node, antigen is present, and it's presented by dendritic cells, which are here in red. And then they have two cell types. One green are antigen-specific CD8 T cells, and blue are control CD8 T cells. And hopefully you can appreciate these cells are all swimming around, but in the end, the green cells find the red dendritic cells and they form contacts, and they will form relatively long contacts, get activated, and mount an immune response to this antigen. Okay. So what do people do? There is software analyzing these movies, and basically the software follows every individual cell and translates that into a track. And a track is nothing more than the XYZ coordinates of this cell in this three-dimensional field with a number for it, for which cell number it is, right? So cell number one has this little track, the track of cell number two starts over there. So that is basically the data. With one little caveat, that this software is not very good. If cells meet each other in this three-dimensional space, that their paths cross, then the software may mistake cells and switch identities of the cells on this track. So we have written papers saying that if you analyze this sort of data, you should be very careful with analyzing it on the level of tracks. It's much better to do your analysis on the individual time steps and get as far as possible, because then you're not hindered by this problems with the software. So what do people do? They have these tracks. They plot them so that you plot all the tracks in a three-dimensional coordinate system, letting them all start at the origin. And then you can, by visual inspection, see whether the cells are all moving in the same direction or not. And the first big surprise was that if you do this in a normal lymph node and you plot these tracks, that it all looks very random. So cells in the lymph node basically do a random walk. Yes, please, Catherine. Yeah, for instance, if you want to do the total displacement along a track and your track switches identity somewhere in the middle, it would...
Would it? Because yeah. I mean, I'm arguing actually that no, because the point is that they're equivalent cells, and the fact that one chose to go right and one chose to go left after the interaction is, in a sense, completely stochastic and random. If you're making a mistake with your bias, then it shouldn't introduce any bias in the data either.
You're right, but let's just wait a bit. So people make these track plots, and I said this is the first surprise, because everybody beforehand was thinking that lymphocytes, if they enter a lymph node, they have an entry point, then there is chemotactic gradients steering these cells around, and then there is an exit point and they leave again. If that were true, then all these tracks should have a direction along this gradient, and that is apparently not true. Lymphocytes just do... Yeah, please.
Is that true, Robin? All the areas of the lymph node?
I'm talking T cells today. It's in the T cell area, okay. But in the T cell area, there's entry points and exit points.
Thank But if you look in the subcapsular areas or in the B-cell areas...
Yeah, there it will be, but subcapsular areas, that will be directed because it's very narrow.
Right.
B-cell areas, I don't know, but I expect it also to be random, fairly random. Tom will could confirm that probably. So now the model is a T-cell enters, it walks this semi-random path, and when it hits an exit point, it will exit, and it's not really going into the direction of the exit point. People record the speed of a cell along this track, the angles that they take, and people make mean square displacement plots to see how what sort of area the cells are covering. So let's take you through a few of these things. Mean square displacement plot is something easy. It's like diffusion in physics. You plot the displacement along a track, and you have these, for every track, you have many of these displacements. As a function of time, so you do mean square displacement or displacement as a function of square root time, and a simple diffusion-like equation will tell you that this should be a straight line. And then people argue that if deviations from the straight line, for instance, if it goes faster, the cells are having directed migration because they cover a larger distance in less than expected time, and if this flattens off, then there is confined migration. The cells stay sort of where they are. And because this is cells and not infinitely small molecules, there is always a sort of persistence time in the beginning because cells cannot make turns at infinitely small times. They have a cytoskeleton, so they have a direction at which they are going, and also only on a somewhat slower time scale they can change direction. Then there is a measure called confinement ratio, because people like to quantify whether cells are staying in the area where they are. And confinement ratio is defined by displacement divided by path length. Here is a cartoon of this. So this track here, the cell ultimately does this small displacement over a very long path length. So you could say this cell is confined. It's not covering a large area. But then if you do the math, so we know what the expected displacement of a cell is by just solving the diffusion equation. And then you do the displacement divided by the path length, and path length is basically speed times time. Then you see that this measure that people are using still contains square root of time, saying that the longer your tracks are, or the longer you do your analysis, the more evidence you find for confinement. So there are several papers out there that claim that cells have a confined motion using this measure. So we should all doubt that. And if you want to define it this way, at least correct your definition by taking out the square root of time and make it independent of time. I'm afraid that this sort of measures will, if path cross and the total path lengths change because cells cross path, will be influenced. So this is one of the examples. And then here's the prime example. So the main problem with these movies is that the meshes, the movies that we make, are in a reasonably large XY field, but a very narrow Z stack. So here is, so typically the Z dimension is a few cell diameters. And this means that mostly our tracks are very short. The cells move in from the bottom or from the top, and after a few steps they are out again. Some tracks will be very long, and that's the cells that move a bit slower, and they stay in this small area for a longer time. So if you do a track-based analysis, for instance, a mean square displacement plot in time, then if you would do a simulation of this, if cells just do normal displacement, if you would restrict yourself to cells that are observed in this small box, you will find evidence for confinement, because there is this bias for slow cells. So the longer the track is, the more enrichment you have for slow cells. Okay, well, I said we wrote this review about it, discussing all of this and illustrating that indeed it's not trivial to analyze this sort of data. There's one very other important experimental point. In several of the movies, you can see that this tissue is not completely static. This is the mouse is still alive, so the tissue is moving a little bit, or the tissue is changing a little bit in size due to the experimental conditions. So there will be global changes in this tissue, which if you just do a displacement or migration analysis, you will think that cells are moving in one direction because your whole tissue is moving in this direction. So if you want to analyze the migration properties or the directional movement of the cells, you definitely have to correct for tissue drift. Later on, I will show a movie where you visually easily see this tissue drift, but even small tissue drift that is not visible to the eye will influence your analysis. Okay, this was all introduction. Let's get started.
Rob, would it help if we lower the lights a little bit?
Over here. A bit too dark, I would say, yeah? Yeah, I think. Videotaping. I'm videotaping. Yeah, that will work.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, so here on the left, you see a movie from the Mark Miller lab. It was in the early times. It's a normal lymph node, and there is no antigen present. In red, you see T cells, and in green, you see dendritic cells. And this is this random movement of T cells in a normal lymph node. And what they did is all this analysis that I just discussed. Here you see the velocity profiles of, what is it, 5 different cells. And one of their results was that these velocities are very irregular. T cells are really, sometimes they're going at high speed and then they seem to stop and then they're going at high speed again. They did even a Fourier analysis on this, showing that at short time scale, at a period of about a minute, your Fourier spectrum peaks. And what they argued, and I think this is inspired on bacterial movement, is that T cells do a stop and go behavior. They walk for a while, they stop, they change their direction, and then they walk for a while again, very much like this stumbling of bacteria. Yeah, please.
One question. What powers their movement?
That's not such a dumb question, and there's also not such an easy answer. but basically, it's cytoskeleton and actin-based. So the actin filaments are within the cell are expanding in the front, and they are retracting at the back. And probably this cell has attachments to other cells or to some scaffolding molecules in the lymph node and it's pulling itself along. Okay, so the conclusion of this was random walk, irregular velocity, stop and go behavior, no directionality. And we decided to study this more and to analyze this data. And the first thing that we did is develop a model. And the movie that you here see is from that model. So you see here the outcome of a computer model developed by Joost. With the aim of creating an environment, a virtual environment, that had all the normal realistic properties of the real thing. So cells are moving in the correct speed, cells have the right size, they have the correct displacement and things like that. Such that we can repeat the experiments that people do if they make real movies, and then we can validate all the methods a bit better. So this model is a cellular POTS model, and we are really fond of this type of model, and one of the very nice things is that in the next 5 or 6 slides, I can explain this whole model to you. In 5 minutes from now, you will all understand what we do. Every detail of this model will be apparent to you, which is good, because if you want to be critical of what we do, you should know what we do. So this is a simple enough model that it can still be explained to an audience in 5 minutes. So here we go. The cellular POTS model is coming from physics. It's a grid-based model. So we have a three-dimensional lattice, and every biological cell occupies an area in this lattice. And here this is two-dimensional just to keep the visualization simple. So here I have a T cell. You see this T cell has a volume or a size, and it has a neighboring point with other cells, like here the open space and here with another cell. with another T cell, and here with a dendritic cell or an antigen-presenting cell. What we then define is that between every neighboring edge, there is an adhesion value. So every cell has, according to its surface area, all different adhesions with other cells. So we sum all the adhesions in the system, and then we know the volume of the actual volume of every cell, that's V here, and every cell gets a target volume. We say a T cell wants to be this size, and a dendritic cell wants to be that size. And basically, we sum that over the whole space. That gives us an energy value or an Hamiltonian, and then we are going to minimize energy. It's all phenomenological, by the way. So what is the game? We pick a random neighboring point, like here. We ask if this cell number 3 would copy itself onto a neighboring point, cell number 5. What is the change in energy? So because we have to break a few bonds and some two volumes are changing. And if this is favorable or slightly favorable, we do this. And then this is the next state of the system, and you pick a new neighboring point, and so on. So this is the basics. Now we have to add on two details, or a few details. For dendritic cells, it's really important that they have a relatively small volume, but a very large surface area, because many T cells can make a contact with one dendritic cell at the same time. And we do that by extending the cellular pot model by saying that at the center point of a dendritic cell, we artificially grow a little rod in one randomly chosen direction. And this rod will grow, and then the CPM will grow the cell around this rod. And then after a while, we retract that rod again, and we choose a new random direction to grow another rod. And then you get this sort of behavior, cells with dendrites sticking out. But the main thing to do this is to increase the surface area of our dendritic cells, giving them a realistic volume. And then for T cells, we also have to add something. T cells move. Well, to let them move, we give every T cell at the start a target direction. So that's the direction in which it would like to move. For instance, you could interpret that as the orientation of its cytoskeleton. And then if a cell wants to do an update, for instance, this blue pixel wants to extend in that a green pixel there, we measure the angle with the target direction, and the smaller this angle, the higher the probability that we will do that. So that will mean that updates in the front of the cell here, aligned with the target direction, will be more likely. And shrinking at the back of the cell, where you are at the maximum angle with the target direction, is also most likely, and that pushes the cell forward. So here you see an example of one T cell in an empty space walking sort of directionally, but also due to all the noise in this system, random. And we just add one term to the Hamiltonian to take care of this. And then, since this directional movement, this target direction can be interpreted as cytoskeleton orientation, what we do is that every so many time steps, we change the target direction of the cell by making it equal to the previous movement of the cell. So if the cell is turning, we just turn the target direction along with it. So that on a small time scale, cells can turn, and on a short time scale, they move directionally.
Rob, does the model account for exogenous reasons why the cell might turn direction, interactions that don't depend on contact, like a chemokine gradient or something?
Yeah, you can, via a sort of similar term, that the cell measures the amount of chemokine in front of it, and then you make updates in that direction more likely than others. Yeah, we don't do that here, but it has been done. Yeah. Yeah, we don't. It's just phenomenological. I have a slide on that. The last detail, the T-cell area in a lymph node is not just empty space or fluid cells. There is this static reticular network there, which we model by adding a large number of randomly oriented rods, fixed rods, into the system that don't move and they stay there. So what we try to do is to have the correct density of these rods, And then all these numbers also give you the size of the movie that we are doing. To be fair, if we leave out these rods, then you will get global motion in your system. You need obstacles for cells to not form streams that they all go in the same direction. Okay, so here's the answer to the question that was just. So I'm done. You all know what is in the model. I just want to remind you on the coloring. So this is a two-dimensional slide of this model. So we have these rods. They will be gray or whitish, empty space. We will have dendritic cells, and they come in two flavors. They are completely identical, but a small fraction of the dendritic cells will be labeled, because that is also what is happening in the real experiments. A small fraction of the cells is injected and has this fluorophore. And we have T cells. They're also identical, but a small fraction is labeled, and the red are labeled and the blue not. So I told you everything there is in the model. And indeed, I want to emphasize again, this is all phenomenological. And all the parameters of this system, they are tuned by intuition. We have tuned the parameters such that cells have the right size, cells take the right angles, they have the correct speeds, and they have the correct displacement. But there's no biological value to any of the parameters that we have here. Yes, please. I didn't say anything about it. When we were publishing this the first time, we did not let a cell adhere specifically to this network, but then publications came out suggesting that T cells walk along the network. They use the network as a scaffold to walk. Yeah, and then so now in the model we have an increased adhesion for T cells on the network. So if possible, a T cell will adhere to this network and will then tend to walk along the rods. Not exactly, because it's very noisy. So we make these cells preferentially attached to rods. But for instance, if there is many cells, then not every cell can be attached to a rod. So we implement this movement along the rod by just increasing the adhesion. So cells have a higher likelihood of sitting on a rod. Okay, so this was the model. And now we can do experiments with the model. So here's this movie taken from the model that you already saw. But now I can do an experiment that no experimentalist can do. I can mount a video camera on the head of a T-cell. And then visualize what this T-cell is seeing, right? So this movie on the right here is the same simulation as the movie on the left. But visually, and I think visual representation is important, you get a completely different impression. Here you have the impression that these T-cells are walking around freely in some empty space. But in this other movie where we are visualizing all the cells, not only the labeled cells, but really all the cells, you see that this T-cell is traveling to a very densely packed space. And now and again, the image just turns blue or it turns yellow, which means that this T-cell has a collision with a large object, like a dendritic cell or another T-cell. So you see here, it's turning yellow for a moment. So this T-cell really collides into a big object, and then it has to slow down and turn and gain speed again.
Is it real time or is it sped up?
No, this is sped up. Yeah. So in blue, you see other T cells. And now and again in red, you will find a labeled T cell.
How many do you do?
How many of these movies?
What's the density of the T cells in your...
There is hundreds of T cells there and hundreds of dendritic cells. You can appreciate that a bit. So basically, this picture on the left here is completely full. So just fill the whole space with blue cells proportional to the number of red cells, and with non-labeled dendritic cells proportional to the green cells that you see. So basically the space is full. Okay, and then doing these simulations, we can do similar analysis as the experimentalists do. Follow, for us that's very easy, we make no mistakes if we follow the tracks of these cells. So we make tracks of cells, plot their velocities, and check whether they have the right speeds and things like that. And to our surprise, we get the same irregular velocities as Mark Miller was getting in his movies, in his simulations. Which should make us wonder, which should make us all wonder, because Mark Miller interpreted these irregular velocities as evidence for stop and go. And I told you, everything that we have in our model, and I didn't use the word stop and go, we don't have stop and go behavior in our model. Apparently, stop and go behavior comes about in systems like this. It's not encoded in the cells. So we went back to Mark, and he said, look, our simulation gives exactly the same velocity profiles as you get. Could you make longer tracks for cells? Which is very tricky because of these small volumes. So they did a lot of new work. And then here on the left, you see the new tracks that Mark collected. So these are tracks of about 30 minutes. And here you see the tracks that we get out of our simulation. And you can appreciate that they are really very much the same. And then if we do an autocorrelation or a Fourier analysis on all of these data points, then there's no longer any evidence that there is a peak at 1 minute. But if we do autocorrelation on short tracks, on say the first 64 data points, then indeed you get some evidence that at short time scales cells are stopping. So the result that Mark was getting was because these short tracks by noisiness gave evidence for stopping after 1 minute. But if you make really long tracks of real cells, there is no evidence for stop and go. And if you make a simulation where there is no stop and go, you also get the same sort of irregular velocity profiles. So we think the stop and go that Mark reported was due to these collisions and not encoded in the cells. No gene for stop and go in T cells. Another thing that we can do very easily is to measure how many T cells every dendritic cell is encountering per hour or per minute, to know something about how easily do T cells find dendritic cells. So here we do a sort of parameter sweep, but at a realistic T cell velocity and at a realistic dendritic cell surface area, we see that a dendritic cell is scanning about 2,000 unique T cells per hour. So that is a number that pops up. This number is not very different from what people have tried to do experimentally. So it's really, we think a dendritic cell is scanning a few thousand T cells per hour.
Well, what's the probability that a dendritic cell will scan the same T cell more than once?
That's sort of the ratio of these two lines, because there's 1.5 higher, I would say. So it's probability 70%, something like that. That's a quick, I don't know if this is correct, but this is what I would do quickly. Yeah, the same question was asked here. You obviously could not hear at the back there. So in dashed line, the dashed line is the total number of T cell scans per DC. The solid line is the unique ones. So I was answering here that the dashed line is about 1.5 fold higher than the solid line, so about 70%. If we now know that a dendritic cell is scanning about 2,000 T cells per hour, I can do this little calculation. How long would it take for a T cell to find this rare dendritic cell that is presenting antigen? And the calculation is simple. Let there be about 100 dendritic cells presenting antigen in a lymph node. They drain that from the tissue. We know this precursor frequency of T cells, 1 in 100,000. A dendritic cell is scanning about 2,000. So the probability that you have no encounter between a T cell and a specific dendritic cell is 1 minus this precursor frequency to the power number of dendritic cells, number of contacts, and the number of hours that I do this calculation for. And if I fill in these numbers, then this is about e to the minus 2t, which I plot here for you. So that means that after 2 hours, the probability that there is no encounter is less than 5%. So the time scale of T cells finding dendritic cells is a few hours, which is easy. And we need an immune response in a few days, so this is not a limiting factor. And indeed, we have new work where we say, this is not an issue in starting an immune response. The main issue is how to get all the T cells in the correct lymph nodes, because T cells stay for long times in lymph nodes, and it's difficult to assemble them in the one or few lymph nodes that are draining the infection. Okay, I switch topics. We introduce antigen. And here is again a movie from our CPM, where the dendritic cells in green are presenting an antigen and T cells are swimming along. And then you see that on a slow time scale, this is 2 hours, T cells are moving and forming clusters with dendritic cells. And we do that in the model by increasing the adhesion of T cells for the dendritic cells if they see antigen there. And here is experimental data on the same process. This is the movie that you already saw in the beginning, coming out of von Andrian's lab. What they do is they have antigen-specific T cells and dendritic cells presenting that antigen. And then they transfer these T cells a few hours before they record the movie. And then they see in this movie how long, what sort of context they observe. So shortly after transferring the T cells, 1 or 2 hours after, 0 to 2 hours after transferring the T cells, the average contact time that they observe is about 17 minutes. After 4 hours, this is 45 minutes. And after 6, 8 hours, the average contact time is about 1 hour. But this is an observed contact time, and the movie is no longer than 1 hour. So you can never get an observed contact time longer than an hour. So what we wanted to try is to, can we, from this observed contact times, can we estimate the true contact time? Because this is biased information, and movies are too short to really observe long contact times. So we again went to modeling. And let me introduce, this was quite complicated. And we defined this set of events. So one, the best event that you can have is that you have a free T cell and a free dendritic cell swimming around. You see them forming a conjugate, and then after a while you see them detaching again. So then this we call an observed event, because you observe the meeting and you observe the dissociation. And then you would know the true contact time for that event. Very often you will see, you'll observe the contact being formed, but then time is up and you never see the ending of the contact. Or you see the contact being formed and then the whole conjugate walks out of view, very many cells walk out of view, and you don't observe the ending of the contact because of we call that a spatial constraint. So that's an OS event, and this is a time constraint. And then these combinations, there's 9 combinations of these. So we started to model this, and our approach was to say there is some true contact time distribution. For instance, the one here, something log normal or gamma-like. And this is the frequency of contact times of these cells. And here between 0 and t, where t is the length of the movie, that is the contact that you can possibly observe, and all these longer contact times are not observable. And then knowing this, or assuming this true contact time distribution, we will predict what we would expect for the observed events. So for instance, if from this distribution, we can make a distribution of events where you observe the conjugate to be formed and dissociate, so an OO event, you would know the exact contact time there, W. The observed contact time can never be longer than T. So from this true distribution, you can go to an observed distribution by just integrating over the distribution. Yeah, so let's get terminology right. We have a true distribution G. We have an expected distribution F with an observed contact time W. And capital T is the imaging time, 1 hour. And then we introduce this parameter delta as the sort of death rate, the probability that the conjugate leaves the space. So there's a fixed probability of the cell leaving the area. This is very poor, because we know that conjugates that are at the boundary of the space, they should have a higher probability of leaving than conjugates that are in the middle. But we were not able to integrate over space and include that into the whole system. So we have this fixed probability. Well, then you can write all these expectations. So I'll introduce this one. For instance, the observed distribution is equal to the true contact times, because you measure the true contact times there. You have to weight that with the probability that this window falls, this observed contact time falls in your observed window. The shorter your observed contact time, the more likely it falls in your movie. And then you have to weight that with the probability that during this observed contact time, this cell walks out. So this is the easy one, and you can do that for all the different expectations, giving you this full model. You can add it all up to see if it goes okay, and then here, if you add it all up, indeed, you get an expression that you can understand again. So we think we did this right. But we... Yeah, please. There is a all normalized to the number of contacts initiated per hour. So there's a unit of time there. Okay. But we had this beautiful cellular POTS model in our lab. So we said, let's now validate this model on artificial simulation. So what we did is, we did a very long simulation, 100 hours. In this long simulation, we can measure the true contact times between the cells, because it's long enough that you don't have all these biases. Then we split this long simulation into 100 short simulations, and then we observe the contact times in these short simulations. We bin that all up. And then we fit our model, the equations on the previous slide, to this data. And you see that it doesn't work. The model describes the data very poorly. We have all these deviations here. Something is terribly wrong. So the method doesn't work. And we figured this is due to this leaving. If a conjugate leaves the area, it is more likely to enter again, and then more likely to leave again. So this entry and leaving is not uniformly uniform over the whole space. And we thought it should be very simple. We can just leave out all the events where cells just entered, because those cells are more likely to leave. So we throw away some of the data, normalize our whole expression again. And then if we do that, so we ignore all the events where cells came in via the spatial constraint. And then we fit our model to this subset of the data, and then it works very well. We get a good description of the virtual data, the in silico data. And if we correlate the true contact duration that we have in our system with the predicted contact duration, we get a beautiful consistence. So we can estimate the method works. And here we used, so we have to assume a through contact time distribution, we here use the sum of two log normals, just as a sum distribution to describe the contact times. When this was all done and we had all our formulas, we saw that it can also be done much simpler. Because we have these expressions, and this expression indeed, here is the number of contacts initiated per hour, times the integral over the contact time times the probability of that contact time. This is the definition of the average number of contacts that you should observe. And since we are interested in this average contact time, we can compute xg of x from the number of conjugates and the number of initiations of the conjugate from nc and from n. So indeed, and you can since the number of initiations should be equal to the number of terminations of contacts per hour, we can even take the number of observed initiations, the number of observed terminations, correct for this two, because you take them both, and you get the observed, you get the estimated contact time for that. And again, if we do that in our model, it works. The true contact time distribution and the estimated contact time distribution are really close to each other. So for the immunologist in the room, if you want to analyze contact data, this is something that you can do yourself. You don't need the help of any mathematician for that. Just observe the number of contacts that you see and divide that by the number of initiations and terminations that you see, and that gives you the contact time, the true contact time. Okay, proof of the pudding is in the eating. So we went to the data. So we took the data from Sarah Hendrickson, fitted that data with this model, assuming various different distributions for the true contact time, and we got this relationship. If Sarah thinks cells are in contact for 15 minutes, we say this is about 0.2 hours. And if Sarah thinks cells are in contact for 45 minutes, we think this is about 10 hours. And there is this exponential relationship between the observed contact time and the true contact time, which is natural because the longer the observed contact time, the larger the error that you make. Anyway, doing all of this, we estimated a contact time of about 5 hours. So I think this is the first time that we can estimate a true contact time distribution from this sort of data. How am I doing on time?
Doing okay.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Another couple. We started late.
Okay. So we go to Amsterdam. That's the third and last topic. So in the lab of Ton Schumacher, they infect mice with herpes simplex virus in the top layer of the skin, in the epidermis of the skin, by some tattoo device. So they make these very small localized infections. And the protocol is the following. First they vaccinate the mice. Then they wait until this mice develops a good immune response. Then they challenge the mouse again at day 10, and one day later they will put a confocal microscopy on the microscope on the skin and visualize the cells that are in the epidermis. And there's always confusion on this point, so let's explain it again. They don't visualize the cells entering the epidermis. No, they only visualize its top layer, so cells that have entered at any time, we don't know. We visualize those movements. So not entry and exit, but just movement of cells in the top layer. And they have various cells. They have a clone that is called GB, that is cells that are specific for an epitope of herpes simplex. As a control, they have OT1 cells. And as a control, they make infections with herpes simplex expressing the epitope of OT1, so then you have an OT1 that recognizes the infection again. And they visualize the cells in green and the infection in red. Here you have a photograph of the infection. So this is a side view. Here you see the dermis layer. So the infection is really on top of the skin, above the dermis in the epidermis only, very thin layer, almost two-dimensional tissue. And here you see a top view. So here, there, and there, this tattoo needle started an infection, and in all of the other areas, there is no infection. So this is many cell diameters apart. And we know that CTLs are very important in this infection because if you immunize the mice with relevant cells, then after the infection, the skin is pretty clear. But if you immunize the mice with irrelevant cells, then the tissue scars. And the infection is clear, but you have this scarring of the infection. So the CTLs are important. So here is a movie of specific T cells in green, and here in red, the infection. So one thing that this movie beautifully shows is this tissue drift. You see the infection moving towards you. Well, this is not happening at all. This tissue is steady. So if you want to analyze the migration of these cells, we have to first correct for this tissue drift. So now the challenge is to say, from all these green cells that are moving around here, are they moving towards the infected cells or not? And I think nobody can tell this visually. We don't know. I can show you the control experiment, where the OT1 cells are in the skin. And apparently, these activated OT1 cells, they go into the skin if there is an infection there. And once they are in the skin, they're also walking around. And it's again very difficult to appreciate whether they are moving towards the infection or not. So we asked the questions, how do T cells end up in these microlesions? Is this just random? Does it depend on antigen specificity? Do the specific cells end up there earlier than the non-specific cells? And how does this work? And it's clear that you cannot just see this. You have to do analysis of the tracks. So what do we do? As I already said, we don't like this track-based analysis. We want to do time point-based analysis. So what we do for the cells, or for at every time point, we measure the turning angles that cells take. What is that turn compared to the previous direction? Which is sort of interesting because this turning angle in two dimensions, the expectation for that is flat. But in three dimensions, this expectation for that is a cosine, if cells take normal random turning angles. And we measure the angle to a point of interest. And of course, for every cell, we can look at where's the closest infected cell. So that it would be your point of interest. And you can measure the angle that the cell takes to the point of interest. And that is over here. We measure the speed of the cell, the turning angle, the angle to the point of interest. And if we know the angle to the point of interest and the speed, we can also compute the displacement towards the infection for every time step. And here's then, we analyze the data. So we get the tracks from Amsterdam. We email them to Utrecht and we analyze them. And here you see the speed as a function of the distance of the cell to the infection. And if the cells are far away from the infection, they walk about 5 microns per minute. And if they are close enough, say 50 microns away from the infection, the specific cells slow down. That's in red. The control cells, OT1, they don't slow down. I would not argue that they speed up, but they don't slow down. And the control cells that were made specific again, they also slow down. So specific cells slow down when they arrive at the infection. And a very natural explanation is the specific cells find antigen and they stop. They start. If you look at the turning angle, then at a large distance to the infection, all cells have a turning angle of about 70 degrees, which basically reflects their persistence. Cells are not making random steps, but are slightly persistent. And then the specific cells, red and blue, they get random turning angles when they arrive, which is, I think, due to the fact that they stop. Whereas the non-specific cells, they just move on. They keep the same turning angle. And then here on the left, the angle to the infection. So the expectation for that is 90 degrees. And then you see that at the starting at about 115 micron from the infection, the cells clearly move towards the infection somewhat. They all have a deviation from this expected 90 degrees. Which disappears when they have arrived. So also non-specific cells know where to go. They go towards the infection. And if you want to quantify that into a displacement, all cells have a relative displacement of about 0.4 micron per minute towards the infection. So there is this very small preference of all cells to move to the infection. And it's true for specific and for non-specific cells. I think that is a natural result because a non-specific cell cannot yet know that it's non-specific if it hasn't seen the antigen yet. It entered this tissue and it only knows that there is some inflammation going on there. Next question is, so we have this preference now. What is the meaning of 0.4 micrometer per minute? Is that relevant or is that just noise in the data? So for that, we turned from this data analysis to modeling again. And we were inspired by the model developed by Catherine Beauchemin. And what is the Catherine Beauchemin model? Very simple. You have a T cell. You choose a random direction. The cell walks at some speed. It stops. It chooses a new random direction. And it walks at the speed. And it goes again. So this is a simple way of modeling T cell tracks. And we used this model. We extended it a little bit by bootstrapping our data. Because we know for cells at different distances to the infection, what their distribution of turning angles is and what their distribution of speeds is. So what we do is we simulate a cell at a particular distance to the infection. We draw from the data a turning angle and a speed. And we let the cell do that movement, and then it has a new distance to the infection. We draw two new parameters, and that is how we simulate tricks. That's sort of a bootstrapping procedure. But it's a bit more complicated, because if you do that, then you don't keep the normal persistence into account. Cells have this persistent movement. So we do a bias drawing. We draw these two parameters, and if this is within the expected persistence turning angle distribution, we accept that draw, and otherwise we draw again. And now we can model this and start cells at a particular distance to the infection, and then let them do this bootstrapping of the data, and we measure whether they arrive. And here in the left, you see that cells starting in this circle around the infection, almost all of them arrive at the infection. That's this blue bullet. And here we do the same system, but we don't take the angle from the data, but we take a random angle. And then you see that most cells don't arrive. So this very small preference to move towards the infection is enough to let most cells arrive at the infection. And this is quantified in this last slide, where we compare here the fraction of cells that arise at the infection if they started at a specific distance. And if we bootstrap the data, all cells arrive. If we randomize the data, many cells don't arrive. And then here you see what is the arrival time of the cells that arrive. And indeed, if we do the real system, cells arrive fast, and the cells that arrive on the randomized migration, they arrive later. And the time scale, it's hours different, and it's a large fractional difference. So, what did I tell you? Stop and go movement is probably just due to the collisions. The random migration of T cells in lymph nodes is fast enough, it's efficient enough for T cells to very rapidly detect antigen. The true contact time between T cells and antigen-specific cells is about 5 hours in the end. Cells in local tissues are attracted to infections independent of their specificity. This directionality is very, very small, very minor, very difficult to detect, but nevertheless quantitatively very important. Thank you very much. So this trick analysis, if we had data on different subsets, this analysis of the tricks is very powerful. These very small differences we can detect. So if cells were to migrate differently, if different subtypes were to migrate differently, we would definitely pick that up with the analysis here. Yeah, the cells that we are modeling are naive cells, so because they haven't seen the, it's not completely true. In the skin, it's memory cells because there was a vaccination, sorry. That will be difficult, because if you look at these movies, you see that some cells are sort of arrested while others are still moving. And we think that the arrested cells have already found antigen, even though the area where they are is not yet red, because they see antigen better than we can see with our microscope. So it will be difficult. So we could say this cells that are that have stopped is a different subset. And if you would do an analysis on that, you would find that. But this could be a subset because they have found something, while as the other subset is still searching for the antigen. So if you I think you need you have to know which subset is what to really pull that out of the data. Maybe you can make groups of cells behaving this way and that way, but it will be difficult to interpret that without having evidence that it's a truly different subset. Yeah, so I think this data tells us that there is some chemokine gradient or some other gradient. Cells know, can sense some directionality here. They know where to go, but it's extremely stochastic. If you follow an individual track, there's no evidence at all that this cell is moving in. So we think there is some chemokine gradient. We are doing experiments to identify which chemokine it is, but this is still ongoing. Did that answer your question? I'm not complete. Okay. Yeah. Tom.
Okay, one more question. Well, Rob, so I think you were telling us that every VC scans about several thousand T cells per hour, and then the contact time between T cells and specific APC is one order of hour.
No. I understand your confusion. It becomes a few hours. So if a specific T cell lands on a TC presenting antigen,
yeah,
then they ultimately develop a contact that takes a few hours. But in the
right.
beginning, they make short contacts. So when a naive T cell is scanning a dendritic cell and there's no antigen, this contact will be very short.
But that's exactly what the question was. So
yeah. Yeah. Which was, remember these plots when in Sarah Hendrickson's data, shortly after the injection of the cells, she measured these short contact times, and later they were longer. So over time, the contact times become longer. And we think T cells accumulate, we are modeling this at the moment, from the short contacts, T cell accumulate activation, and then at some point they get involved in this long contact.
Thank you, Rob.